Okay, it is my fortunate state of being that I can ask you a lot of questions, and I hope that it will induce our audience or participants to ask the question. This may sound very funny, but do you know that during your recital, which I'm sure you were thinking that I'm going to ask something about Nadia Boulanger.
No, I don't have any idea at this point. I have a salad of music in my head of all the pieces I taught, and they're playing at the same time in my head. It feels like a contemporary piece. So, please,
who needs a microphone?
Ask me questions that you need. I don't want to be Boulanger, it's okay.
I don't need, but you actually, I remember we wrote to each other that there will be an intermission.
I'm sorry.
Well, I have to break the ice. And this is the biggest ice I can break, because I have a feeling, I have a desperate feeling that your leather is much better than mine.
Such irony. I would say that when I was playing in Paris as a young upcoming concert pianist, the Paris stages don't own their piano. They rent it for each concert from piano stores. And there are several available pianos for rent, which are usually reserved ahead of time because they're a favorite of Pariah, or the favorite of Brendel, or the favorite of Ungar, and so inevitably, at some point, when you play in Paris a concert, and there are like 10 concerts going on the same evening, the inevitable happened. There was no more Steinway available for the concert. And so I went to the Bösendorfer store, and I asked the Bösendorfer technician, I'm playing tonight Mussorgsky Pictures. How am I supposed to play on the Bösendorfer? And he told me, there is one thing you should know, is don't lift your fingers above the keys, no matter what, because it's not a Steinway. And like here, the piano have these beautiful large wheels with the brake lock. That was almost 30 years ago now. They brought it on the stage of the Champs-Élysées Theatre, and the technician forgot to lock the brakes. So I start sol, fa, si, do, fa, re, do, fa, re, so, and I start with the big chords that follow, and all of a sudden I feel like, seriously, he started to move, because those oversized wheels are made to be easily moved. And so what happened is that as soon as the promenade was finished, I brought the piano to me for the next movement. Pieces. So I was thinking at that point, I should stop, get out of stage, have somebody lock them, and go back on stage and continue or restart. But I noticed that once you're on, you're on. In terms of intellectual focus, concentration, you're driven. And I felt like if I stop that momentum, then the concert will be not what it started to be. Because I love the fact that the concert is a one-time moment, it's like live. You rehearse for the things, but then they happen the way they do. Sometimes silly, sometimes as you expect, sometimes better than you expect, but generally one time. At the time. And so when I started the concert yesterday, was it yesterday? No, 2 days ago. The way I had organized the program was made to follow in tonalities. And so I felt like, I remember vaguely around the Valse Noble getting a little bit disconcentrated, thinking, perhaps Tamás needs an intermission, and I don't remember where we decided it. It was during the waltzes, and then when I finished the last waltz, I felt like, oh, perhaps there's not much left, so I'll just continue. But I must say that I owe you all who attended it, and you too, a great apology, because I was recently having some operation where you mentioned earlier. And so I really feel very bad that I was inconsiderate for the natural break that we all need. Are any of you soccer fans or nobody soccer fan here? Yes, I am a great admirer of the system that used to be without the video referee. Because for those who know, the video referee kills the momentum of the game. And so I felt the same thing a little bit. If I stop, I felt like the whole piece was, the whole concert was one bookshelf end to the other with Fauré. And it was the students of Fauré, like the Boulanger sisters and Ravel and Dupont, and then him. Anyway, so that I think now I'm really officially, please forgive me.
Not at all. I had to think of something to start off with, because I have a feeling that we're going to become serious. And and so I thought that the best way to start is with humor, and I do believe very strongly that life without humor is very dull. And with you, in the last couple of days, it has been extraordinarily colorful.
In a positive color.
Very, absolutely positively. I mean, it has been a joy to be with you, to talk to you, and I must say that you are, in your playing as well, a surprise, which is a very
good. That is a very, very interesting way to
put it. No, you think negatively, but I think.
I keep on saying your piece is very interesting. Surprise.
Well, I look on this, I'm influenced very much by Richter's comment that good music that is played extraordinarily well, it's full of surprises, so nobody can sort of predict what happens next. And with you, it's the same thing. I mean, with your performance, your teaching, it was full of, no, but in a very positive way, Sami.
You mean the spontaneity?
Yes, but it was also, I had a feeling that you, your intellect guides you in the right direction always.
I don't know, I think that it's more my intuition.
With a couched in intellect, let's put it this way. So, tell us about, well, you already talked about your recital, how you prepared for it, and we have to say that you had very little time to prepare, because I asked you only about 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago to come, and I wanted to say this in front of everybody, how much I appreciate the fact that when I wrote to you, not daring to call you because I hate being told no in the face. Somehow email is much better. But you were so gracious, and ever since then you have been wonderfully wonderful.
I wanted to say that for my first visit, this place is so exhilarating. Everybody gives themselves earnestly 110%. Shrifun yesterday was just unbelievable. 36 concerti, yeah. Orchestra parts in a row with equal quality. And also, Tamás Morbis organizes, teaches, and always gracious and never tired. I'm just very, very impressed, because ultimately it is the drive to do well, to transmit well, to bring something well. It's not just sitting on our seats. And I find that you are a great orchestrator of this festival. Very much so. And I must say, for the rest of the world.
Now that we have patted ourselves on the back, let's get down to business. No, I'm very interested, for instance, what was the first, I sometimes ask this question, but with you I'm particularly interested, what was the first inkling that music will take over your life?
It was interval. I'm surprised you hear that. D flat F, literally in interval.
Okay.
It's awkward, but is the answer the truth? Is this? Sorry, with my knee. Is this interval? It was just D flat F. And my parents brought me to a piano teacher, as they always do, you know, to start.
How old were you?
I was 5. I was not very young. But I didn't have a piano at home because my parents didn't have a piano. And they brought me to a piano teacher, Liliana Panayotova, in Sofia, where I was born. And I remember this lesson as clearly as it was yesterday. She told me the name of the notes. This is Do, this is Re, you know. And somehow, I didn't know that the pitches were preset in my head. And since the day she showed me which note is which pitch, I hear it. And from there on, the fascination with the combination of the sounds literally moved me, probably like people are moved by images or colors or shapes, just the sounds. And I only felt like this is something in which I feel I'm almost like a, I didn't know how to say it, like a vibrant membrane. And the first thing I did is that when my parents bought a little Petrov upright chick, piano. This is, we talk early 60s in Bulgaria. I was given my little pieces and I immediately started playing around the pieces. So my father took them on a recording device. Today nobody remembers the reel-to-reel magnetophone, the old Bulgarian days, how they called it. And he recorded me saying my name, the date, and the piece I'm going to improvise. And I played it, or improvised it, whatever I made up. And then he took it on dictation from the recording because of his music skills. He was not a musician professionally, but he could take that. There was no computers then, there was no software for any of that. And then the only thing, because he was a scientist, a medical doctor, he told me, now you're going to practice your piece from the score and not make it up. And so I was practicing my piece next to the other pieces I was practicing, from the score obviously, but in my father's writing. And since we have the recordings, and I have my father's writing, I can say that very little was lost, meaning in the translation. And Bulgaria is a very small country, you probably never heard of it. And the capital is supposed to be wisdom in Greek, but they forgot the PH, so it became F. So not very wise, Sophia. And there was not much classical music tradition there. And my father was nicknamed Leopold Naumov, because they said, oh, he's writing his son's pieces, and which is not true. And one of his patients told him, you know, you should bring the little one to Nadia Boulanger. And my father asked, so who is she? He says, I don't even know if she's alive. Because with the Iron Curtain, there was no connection out of Bulgaria to know what happens in Paris. But this person met her in the 30s when he studied in France. So he said, she would know what to do with a child in music. And my parents took the Orient Express with me, and we left one way, as it was then. You cannot go back if you leave, because you don't have the right to return. Or if you return, you don't leave anymore. And I auditioned for Mademoiselle Boulanger in her salon with her guests. And she turned to my father and said, I would like the little one to study 10 years from now with me. And she was 84. And I was not barely 7. And my father taught her absolutely. And my mother was panicked. Georgie, how would you do that? We have barely enough to cover the hotel stay for the next 2 days. You know, I mean, it's not like is unified Europe like today with the EU and all these common things. It was really a big leap in the unknown, which my father had the intuition that was the right thing. Of course, my teacher was very gracious to offer me her tuition. I never had to pay for my lessons. But she was very strict, which she would have been strict even if I paid for them anyway. But the point of the story is that I think I then started learning how to notate my thoughts in music. Therefore, I graduated from my father writing my pieces. And I think that this combination of being able to notate my music that was in me, that I hear inside me, was very liberating. And Mademoiselle Boulanger insisted I don't improvise, but I write to organize my thought process. And preferably with a pencil without eraser, so I focus not to make mistakes. All kinds of little old-fashioned ways, but very strict. And which was this upbringing to have. And I think that this initial interval and my first compositions and practicing piano became my inner world. I didn't have friends of my age because I was constantly working with music. And I must say that the pieces of music became my friends, especially the well-tempered clavier, which started me on right away weekly. 2 days copy, 2 days from memory copy, 2 days play on your own score, and in parts in clefs. And then next week, the next prelude fugue, and on and on and on. So I think that music is grammar, but it's also emotion and imagination. And for me, it was fulfilling this imagination. If my father had not accepted this opportunity, I probably would have become delinquent. Because you can easily get bored when you're a very bright and child and manipulate people and think that you're a little king. It's easy because people like to, they think it's cute until they find that it's obnoxious. And then my parents didn't allow this to happen, and my teacher neither. And so I must say that the music was this fascination, almost a sensorial feeling about music, till today, especially if you listen to orchestra. I think you imagine it on the piano. Yesterday's concert in the orchestra was so fantastic. Even with the Sturm und Drang at the end. Literal Sturm und Drang. But I mean, when you hear basses in the orchestra, they're deep. They're deep. The octaves played by the double basses, one octave under the cello. And on the piano, because it's percussive, it's easily loud or banged. And I find that it's all these kind of ways to shape the sounds. It's almost like a sculpture of sounds that I like to do on the piano, imagining the orchestra in the case of the Requiem, also the voices. And I must say that Schmifun yesterday really impressed me, playing the orchestra with the left hand so well. I used to play for Henrik Schering as a sparring partner, and he told me the first thing he said, don't play octaves in the orchestra reductions in the left hand. And I said, but it sounds more like the orchestra. He said, only bad pianists do that. Have you played for Henrik Schering?
I just
heard. He was very scared.
Actually, I do have a story about Schering.
Oh, good.
With my best friend, we played the D minor Brahms sonata for him. And he must have fallen asleep, because when we finished, he said, okay, I like the first movement, but I think we should improve on the second and third. So would you like to do it again? Would you like to play it? He thought that we finished the first movement, actually. But that was, he was quiet.
But go ahead.
No, I'm just saying that for me, music became a necessity. And I remember that when Mlle Boulanger was extremely worried that I would not go to school, because she thought it's important for me to get a schooling, though it was in Paris and I didn't speak the language at the beginning and all that. So she obtained for me to receive a studying scholarship so I can pay my mother, of course, took care of all these things, but also was my mentor for a private school with preparing programs weekly and being only interrogated for the classes. So my mother woke me up at 4 to 5 a.m. in the morning until 8 to do school. And 8 to 12 I would practice piano. And then afternoon was lessons. And then evening was homework for lessons. It sounds terribly tedious, but it was so much fun. Especially because Mademoiselle Boulanger prepared each of the three weekly lessons of 3 hours with a very respectful, prepared way. It wasn't just like, well, just repeat the same. The first hour I play what I practiced. The second hour is harmony, contrapoint, or fugue, whichever of the academics. And the third hour, which was my favorite, was sight reading. And there was always a thick volume, like the old days when people had their own libraries with the thick covers, you know. And there was always a thick volume that had like Bible-sized amount of pages. And then there would be a little paper on the top with Emile written on it. And so I would open that page, 670-something, and it would be not piano music specifically, as a matter of fact. It would be mostly choral music from the Renaissance, and it would be things in the clefs. But also, and it was so marvelous, because I was discovering pieces in front of her. She was not saying much. Just from time to time, she would growl when I dared sight read a wrong note, like B flat in the tenor. It's not tenor, is it? It's too quartet. It's an viola. Witchcraft. And so on. And so it would be a quartet or a quintet with two violas by Mozart. And it wasn't the same genre or the same style each lesson. So it became for me the hour I felt almost deserving the hour to discover these things, because I went through the more academic things. And when I studied in the Paris Conservatory, while I was studying privately with her in Paris, since she was already beyond age to be, she was obviously retired, I had a very difficult situation to handle personally between my piano, chamber music, conducting, and other solfège, and other teachers at the conservatory, because they knew I was a Boulanger student. And so my piano teacher, Mademoiselle Mousseau, was telling me always, do you think Mademoiselle would accept the crescendo in this section? And I was, please tell me, because I'm not her spokesman. And then, unfortunately, the clashes happened on the 20th of February, which was my birthday. Mademoiselle would say, it's time for you to prepare for your birthday. You should compose a piece for this, 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 and that instrument that will play at your birthday. And then I'll invite all your teachers. And it finished with, and Emil will play his 13th Nocturne by Fauré, which was almost the slaughter. Because nobody can play the 13th Nocturne by Fauré, let less Emil. And so each birthday, she invited Madame Dutilleux, who was my chamber music teacher, Mademoiselle Cousseau, my piano teacher, Mademoiselle Gervais, my analysis teacher, etc. And this little chorus of old ladies, marvelously conserved by their musicianship in some kind of ageless age, which is so typical for Parisian elegance. These ladies, like Madame Cassé-Dessus, are like, it's marvelous. Anyway, unfortunately, my teacher was their senior. And so I would finish the 13th Nocturne, and then Mademoiselle Boulanger, typically, as many thoughtful teachers, I'm sure she must have done that too, doesn't speak right away. And so there's great little discomfort in that silence. And my piano teacher, Mademoiselle Rousseau, broke the ice by saying, isn't this adorable, this nocturne? Which obviously was a terrible adjective for the kind of music that it is, especially Mademoiselle, who was for a student. And I remember Mademoiselle looking at her and telling her, Madame, you can dislike Fauré, but you cannot diminish Fauré. And God forbid, this was an extraordinary musician lady. It wasn't like, and Mademoiselle Boulanger disrespected her by saying, I think you should leave the salon now. And I was sitting on the piano after my 13th nocturne, thinking, what will happen on my piano lesson after tomorrow? When my teacher was evicted by my other teacher. And I learned at that point to have a little bit of a diplomatic, if you want, skills. Because I realized that even alive in her very old age, Mademoiselle Boulanger was considered, if not dead, at least a little bit outside of the reality of the day. Oh, she was Stravinsky's supporter, and Stravinsky's dead. Oh, she was Copland's teacher, and Copland is very old. It seemed like she was from two world wars before. And this is in the Cold War, and she was famous for what she did before World War I. And so that's why I'm saying that I learned to filter what I received from the different teachers instead of confronting it. And I am very thankful to all of you who took lessons with me this festival, because I'm very cautious knowing that you all have your teachers. And inevitably, just by my earnest way to describe, teach, organize the thoughts of the piece, I might inevitably come in conflict with an opinion of another teacher. And I agree to disagree, it's not the point, but I don't want the student to become confused. And I think that I learned how not to get confused quite early, because I was surrounded by this plethora of old ladies who were very strong-minded individually, whom I respected enormously, but who were competing with each other, especially around Mademoiselle Boulanger and me. So, in that case, I hope that whatever I suggested to the students would be productive, and I told them, don't worry, you'll forget a lot of it anyway. In a good sense, because somehow the harvest happens with time, but I appreciate very much the opportunity, because I find that this intensity and this earnest intensity in transmission of music here reminded me very much of Mademoiselle Boulanger's Summer Academy in Fontainebleau, which was very much like that too. So, congratulations.
Thank you so much. I think we can open it up if anybody would like to ask a question. There is a young lady. No, we have a runner.
Oh, should we put you to that too? You're amazing.
But she does it in a more practical way. She doesn't run, she asks everybody else to run.
There's also this lady who... Oh, anyway.
You said that Diane Jay said her sister was very innocent of the music, and so was Schubert. In what way is Schubert in? What's the characteristic of his music that makes him innocent?
Oh, I know actually what she thought. I don't know that I share it as a musician today, but I think what she wanted to say is that she told me, she said, it's given to some musicians to appear at a given time in the tonal time frame of music, who don't need to question the status quo of the tools they received to express their unicity. And she said Schubert didn't need to revolutionize the tonal system or the formal system, nor did Lili Boulanger, her sister. She said they just naturally brought their contribution. And she was very impressed with composers like Beethoven and Stravinsky, who are constantly changing through their life. And for Stravinsky, she was very well knowing him personally for so many years. But she considered Schubert to be, and Lili Boulanger, in that sense, not fighting and just spreading what they had to spread without the struggle, which is so phenomenally fascinating, of a Beethoven with his deafness, but also before the deafness, you know, the transformative capacity to rethink the meaning of music. In that sense, I think she considered Lili Boulanger and Schubert innocents, though I didn't know any of the two. So I will take her word for it.
Yes, go ahead, the question.
For the audience, I have a comment more than a question. There is on YouTube a video about Madame Nadia Boulanger for her 90th birthday. Mm-hmm. And Monsieur Emile is there. You're playing. I recognize you right away.
Really?
You are 10, 12 years old.
It's very difficult to recognize me anymore.
No, you have more hair, yes.
The cruelty of life, age has made things... But I was a child then,
yes.
Even a little younger, because it was broadcasted on French TV for her 90th birthday. I'm sorry I interrupted. I just completed the fact. But it was filmed a few years earlier.
Yeah, you look very young. You were like maybe 9 years old?
Yeah, it was that, yeah.
Like that, yeah.
It was Bruno Mont-Saint-Jean who made that documentary before he made a documentary on Glenn Gould, which made him very famous. And he also made the documentary on Menuhin. He did the famous last documentary on Richter, for those who have seen it. But this was his first try to make a documentary, because it was in the very early stages of his. And I must say that Mademoiselle Boulanger was a very old-fashioned lady. While intellectually she could think in dodecaphonic way for a student, in atonal different way for another student. She didn't impose her aesthetics. But in terms of relations in society, she was a little bit more rigid. And when some student would say, could I record the lesson, please, mademoiselle? It would be the big no. You have to remember. And so she refused, at least during the 10, 11 years I was there, she refused a lot of offers to be filmed. And she only accepted one time, one afternoon, to be filmed during a class of hers in her apartment, which is what you've seen. 36 Rue Ballu, in her apartment. And there is the two pianos, the Erard and the Steinway, and the pipe organ, and the students all cramped in a small space. And usually it was Emile au piano. Emile au piano was always the question, because I could sight-read basically anything. And this way the students were singing the parts. And we did, in that afternoon of that analysis class, we did Schumann's slow move, second piece of the dancers. David Bündler. Sound like a new one. In C minor by Mozart. And it was interesting because the group that we were there was completely not from the same cloth. You had beautifully like here, you had teachers, you had amateurs, you had students, you had a child prodigy in my case, which is kind of oddity. But I was kind. I was told that I was not arrogant by people who remember me then and told me that lately. So it reassured me a lot for my mother's education. Well, I always do. Happy might be an overstatement because she was relatively scary. But what I kept going for me is that, unlike them, I was a child and they were adults. And whoever is a young adult carries already a history of things that they have to deal with. And I was a clean slate. Not that I was an idiot savant, but perhaps I was. But to a certain extent, I just remember that because she didn't, and I regret she didn't prepare, organize, like Gould did with Mont-Saint-Jean, this series where he took topics. And it was so interesting. I don't know if you've seen those videos where he does the art of the fugue, and then he speaks of the Goldberg variations. And it's fantastic. Mademoiselle Boulanger could have done such interesting shows which she wanted to. But I think since Lily died in 18, age 24, she had this very deep sense of not overshadowing her sister, her students, anybody. She could have written a book on music theory, which she didn't. She could have written a book on her life, which she didn't. She kept teaching. And that single afternoon was randomly picked. And I remember because in 1973, it must have been 04, they were filming with a horrendous amount of extra lights, which made us all cook in that apartment. We were already cramped. There was no air conditioning in France anyway, still not. So the place was relatively uncomfortable for a 3 hours class. And then on top of that, the cameras that they used had a magasin, they used to call it in French, of 15 minutes tape. And so every 15 minutes we had to stop for them to reload and continue. And I remember as if it was today when I was in Boulanger telling them, écoutez, ma pensée ne se coupe pas comme un salami. My thought process doesn't get shredded in slices like salami every 15 minutes. So she said, I do my job, you do yours, and we don't talk to each other. So she went on doing her class as if they're not there. And they were panicked because they didn't want to miss something in a sentence that they couldn't edit after, because it was technology of the day that was relatively heavy and bothersome, and she didn't want to even accept the slightest interruption to her thought process going on in her explanations and her questions of us. And in fact, after she died, we realized it's the only documentary of her teaching. It could have been easily multiplied by many series. It would have been fascinating, because that's how we were. We were fascinated by her. Usually when you leave a class of Mademoiselle Boulanger, you felt a little bit like as if you inhaled helium. You felt a little more intelligent than you really were. Because she was able intellectually to connect dots between literature, philosophy, history, specifics about the piece, music, everything. And in the beginning, it's very difficult to follow her without to get lost in her thoughts process. And she would always finally make the full circle by the time we all lost. And she told us that the first thing her mother taught her when she was a very small child, her mother was Russian, Raisa Michetsky, she told her, you have to learn attention. If you don't have attention, you won't succeed in life. And so she was testing our attention constantly by swinging subjects. And of course, the group that we had there was not in the same country, not in the same age group, not with the same interests in music. So we all captured, I would say, fragments of the great picture that she was describing in her analysis. But I think that none of us really completed the painting. And so what we would do after the class, we would go to the cafe in front of her house, apartment, and we'd start to say, so, what did she say? And some people, they, I wrote down, she said this about a statement by Shakespeare, and somebody, and I remember she spoke something about inharmonic modulation, and we were trying to reconstitute what we went through, because she forbid us to record, so it had to be, and I must say that after the meeting and we left, all of a sudden that feeling that we were so, wow, now we understand things. And all of a sudden, the way that things were presented by her, combining literature, semantics, everything, with music and language and narrative and everything, and religion, and Bach's cantatas, which were her big mantra. Anyway, it's difficult to describe, but I think this snippet filmed remains as a legacy of what that was weekly for years, way before me. But I was there for the last 10, 11 years, and I must say that the film shows a little bit of the atmosphere, but really not much. I regret that we don't have the technology of today and who are willing to be more wanting to contribute, to collaborate.
Okay, there's another question.
I've never met someone who is a composer and a performer, and I wondered what you thought composing, how that affects your performance, and performing affects your compositions, compared to someone who's just a composer or just a performer.
Well, I'm really none of both. So it's easy, because I'm just a musician who does different things that I think are meaningful to do, but I don't know their value. I just know the earnest feeling is an inspiration, and then when Madame Cassé-Dessus was teaching me, she was adorable for this. Écoute mon petit Émile, tu comprends? I'm sorry, I'm taking the voice of the people. Don't make fun of them because I love them. It was like this. She says, my little Émile, you understand, Chopin was a great composer, but he was mainly a great pianist. I think you should stop the composition for now, and you can always compose later, but you cannot become pianist later. And I was like, why? She goes, even Chopin first learned the piano before he composed. And I was surprised at this opposition of what I thought was complementary. And as far as the technique of my pianism as a child, practicing like all of us, the etudes, the practice exercises, the independence of fingers, the strengthening the pinky, flexibility of the thumb, and all these things, my compositions became oddly always more complex to play than I could. No matter how I progressed in piano, I could think more complex than I could play. So I was constantly like Sisyphus, in a constant status quo. It's like, I progress, but I feel like I'm not moving much ahead. And I think that I regret that many great musicians who have composed in their early years have given up on it when they discover the plethora of the repertoire and the importance of the repertoire. The famous moment in front of the mirror, why me? After all this. Okay, when I was young, I didn't know that they wrote it, so I was, in a way, not responsible. But once you heard Bartok, and I remember that happened to me all the time because I would compose music and people would say, oh, that sounds like Bartok, or that sounds like Shostakovich, or that sounds like Stravinsky in for my music. As if I take them as models to copy. But in fact, oddly, most of the times I would go to hear these pieces they mentioned that I didn't know, and I realized that I wrote something in the same musical world as theirs, but it's not that I had the piece that they thought I took to copy from. And Mademoiselle Boulanger's teaching of composition was very peculiar for me, which I think she adapted to me. She was a rigid, like there is no permission to be rigid, but I guess she was even more than that, very, very, very rigid, about all the grammar of music. Solfège, harmonie, contrepoint, fugue, nothing was tolerated. Everything was to be, all the voice leading, all that. But then when I was composing my own pieces, she allowed me all the freedom of all the things that were forbidden in the rules of the grammar, as if I had to learn why I have to learn the restrictions in order to know why I have to free myself from them, but I was doing it at the same time. And I think that when I was composing a piece, I would present it to her finished. She never wanted to hear it in sketches. And then she would tell me specific comments about what to avoid in the next piece. Weaknesses of the writing. But not change it in this piece, nor did she change the piece, or did she ask me to redo the piece. And in a way, I find that it was very helpful because through contrapoint, I didn't have a style specifically, I just learned about intervals. And so my compositions evolved in different, of course I was playing Debussy, of course I would be influenced by Debussy as a child. I was a musical sponge. So inevitably, I could write little pieces to imitate the pieces I like. But that's not what I did. Perhaps improvising, I guess I did. But writing, no. And so one day she was approached by a journalist who asked her, so your latest student is a composer. What is his style of music? And it was a child still. Anyway, it doesn't matter. She answered, Stravinsky? No. Bartok? No. Shostakovich? Perhaps, but not completely. I think he's himself. And I didn't try to be myself, but I managed to compose music that comes out of me, of course, but I was trying to be careful because I was aware of the great influences. I mean, who is not influenced by Stravinsky? Poulenc was influenced by Stravinsky when he wrote his Sonata for Clarinet and Bassoon. It sounds like the Soldier's Tale. And nobody says, oh. Of course, it's because he's Poulenc. And the same thing can be said for many people. Beethoven's B-flat major sonata is the exact opening of the closing section of the E-flat Haydn sonata. And where would we say, oh yeah, you know, he heard it, Beethoven, he stole from Haydn. Or he copied. Now, I think that Mademoiselle Boulanger encouraged me to continue the composition because she encouraged my creativity in the composition, while she discouraged my creativity in the harmony and part writing. So I couldn't just take freedoms with that. So I guess that was the good combination. And the last thing I can say, which I think is very pedagogically interesting in the way it happened, is that Mademoiselle Boulanger, defining herself as a professor of music, but not a composer after her sister's death, was in fact a fantastically open-minded composition teacher for students from different interests of musical language. And God forbids, in the 70s, there were many. You know, Della Piccola and Zenakis and Stockhausen and all kinds of leaders of musical thoughts that the young composers were, or Messiaen, and many more. The students were very driven by this, and they go to her and say, I would like you to teach me how to write good dodecaphonic music. And I think had she been a full-time active composer, as was Messiaen, I think she would have influenced the students to write like Messiaen did when he influenced Takemitsu. And when you hear the tree sketch garden by Takemitsu, you hear Messiaen. But when you hear a student of Boulanger, you don't hear Fauré. You hear themselves. Really. I mean, Copland, okay, a bit Stravinsky when he was young, but really Copland found himself quickly. And so I think that in my case, the piano playing, of course, the major problem was when I was at age to do competitions and in piano. I was often considered, he plays as a composer, which was almost like some kind of contagious disease. Far away, he plays as a composer. And I think the reason is because the way in France the music was taught in the conservatoire at the time I was a student compared to my studies with Mademoiselle Boulanger was aesthetically totally opposite. Mademoiselle Boulanger, we learned the music from the roots up, literally, and in the conservatory at the time, it was mostly reciting the score. And the analytical aspect was not there for the performers. And so my generation, fantastic pianists of French conservatory time, Thibaudet, to take an example, for instance, they didn't identify with me, but, oh yeah, you compose. It's almost like, you're not one of us. we're the pianists. And the composers didn't consider me a composer because I'm a pianist. They say usually, oh, you perform, you can play. I cannot even play my piece, I need somebody to play it for me. And so it feels like I was a little bit, as I said earlier, really honestly, both of none. I mean, it's like, I just do it, but I know I'm not considered for it by the people who consider that you should be only the one or the other. And I think Rachmaninoff in his time was very famous as a pianist too, while alive. Yes?
Good evening. I would like to know more about your thoughts on young artists' career nowadays and compositions. Would you mind sharing with us? Your thoughts on the young artists today and competitions.
Oh, you guys in competitions?
Competitions, that's...
Is yes. that what you said?
Yeah, competitions.
Yes, I reserve that opinion as a teacher, which I didn't have the same as a candidate, obviously. It's basically unfair. Not everybody plays their best or is perceived their best the moment they play on the competition day. And if you take some performer on their longer period, you can see how they evolve, how they develop their repertoire, their reaction to the audience. And then some are not made to be on stage. It's a level of privacy that is invasive. I think music is a level of intimacy that doesn't need to be exhibited. And because artistically, like theater actors, we learn how to do it, it doesn't mean that we're all totally prone to satisfy the essence of it without a bit, to try to a little bit get hard shell over it. I know for my students, I suffer a lot for their competitions because I know that they're going to come back to me a little bit broken, emotionally or intellectually. And I'm not a shrink. They think they should see one after each competition because I think that the competitions are very bad on the self-esteem. But the reason for which they exist is very natural. It's because there are more people who are called than people who are on the helm. And so the filtering is unfair to some. I remember very clearly people who knew Clara Haskell in person. When I studied, many of my teachers were that generation. They would always tell me, when Clara Haskell saw the red light for the recording studio, she played just the notes. And when she played in concert, she took our hearts. But she was very nervous and she didn't sustain the pressure of the recording studio. So to say that, that's the problem. The other thing is that it's very healthy when you can use it as a way to, as a student to, or as a candidate, to motivate yourself towards a goal. Because the plethora of repertoire is almost overwhelming. And therefore, there is a little bit of survival of the fittest, which is unfair. But on the other hand, I think that the beauty of a career is to last. I mean, I blossomed very early in my career, and most of the stages on which, big stages on which I played, they totally forgot I exist because so many younger people arrived almost right away after who need also the limelight after this competition, that competition, and that is, that's how it's supposed to be. But then what do you do after? You could become engineer, you can become medical doctor, you should actually. No, I mean, seriously, because I think that if you want to consider that you want, that music means to you more, like Schumann gave up on law jurist studies, yes. I think that then you have to renew your calling about what you bring through music. Is it through chamber music, either through students, either through exploring a repertoire, like excavating some unknown things? In other words, something has to drive you in music to continue other than the pursuit of a success through what the competitions, bit like lottery, make you hope. I might be tomorrow the winner or not. But the good thing about it is that the repertoire has to be very well learned to sustain the pressure of playing in public. And the competition menopause starts around 32. And I find that very useful to have in mind, because if you hope to have a longer life, you can very well say, hey, I'm going to give 20 years of my youth, because that's what I believe in myself, and I have to do it, regardless if I succeed or not. But then comes the after. And very often, that is where you find the possibility to find, perhaps, that you become an accompanist of Lieber. And what really, I think, is lacking in a lot of our education that we give to the young students is a larger hope for repertoire and music making than only the competition pieces. Like, imagine if you tell a student who arrives and who's driven and who wants to secure a good career and you see it's a talent and everything, you say, I think you should learn the complete Schubert songs, piano part. Yeah, but my friends are playing Waldstein. Then they tell you, oh, you don't believe in me. And if you tell them, yes, but perhaps not everybody will become Horowitz. It is very difficult at a young age to accept. And what happens very often is that most of people practice the repertoires for a great solo career that they won't have by the pyramidal system of the competitions. And when they have to play collaborative music, as they call it, politically correct today, I would say accompanist, which is the very, very beautiful word, they have to sanction. And they have to prepare quickly, because they didn't spend thinking about it like on the Waldstein. And all of a sudden they have to play a Brahms trio, and they go like, in fact, they didn't have the time to mature the Brahms trio as they did the Waldstein that they might not be asked to play. So I think the diversification of the repertoire and the genres, I think, is very essential to help the students have useful grains that they harvest in their garden, so when the time comes, they can pick from there and say, oh, I have perhaps a future as a concert pianist for accompanying leader singers. But you cannot become that by practicing the Beethoven Sonata. You have to know the poetry, you have to know the history of the song, the meaning of it, to play it intelligently. But unfortunately, the competitions for accompanists of singers are not many. And so I think that if you start telling the students that there is valuable way to succeed besides competition in music, it depends how to widen your horizons, not only repertoire but genres.
Any other questions?
Thanks for speaking with us tonight. So I'm going to ask you a question in your role as a composer. How do your ideas come to you? Do you find that you improvise, or are you listening to a symphonic music or music from other instruments, or does it just sort of come to you?
So it happens when I wake up. Literally. I wake up and a piece is playing in my head. Literally playing in my head. As if I listen to the radio or, you know. So what I do usually is that I forget it. Like you forget the dreams usually after you wake up, even if they are very meaningful, they sort of evaporate. But what remains is the perfume of them, the mood of it. And I think that it's also a little bit when you're hungry and you have a favorite food, you already sense it in your palate, in your saliva, because you project it in your mind. Of course, the problem is that if they serve you the food that you expected and is not, then you go home. And that very often happens in composition. It's relatively easy to write a few notes. It's very difficult to write the next ones. Because if you're knowledgeable enough, you can cook it. But I don't like that. I really don't like that. I always admire in the pieces I play the compositions that flow uninterruptedly till the end with an evidence that is difficult to question. And I always try to think, when I write my music, inevitably all people who write, they do a sketch and then a second sketch, etc. What takes me the longest is because I didn't learn, while I learned all these other unnecessary skills today, like the seven clefs, I should have learned how to engrave music on the computer, which I didn't. And so my process is slower because I write it on paper and then, as I like to say, I copy it clean. In the process, I make changes. And that's usually when I realize that I lost the original thread that was so natural. Then I say, oh, no, not good. So I only select the pieces like that. As far as the improvisation is concerned, it's a very different aspect of music making. Personally, improvisation is very freeing for me. Somebody one day told me that I have offstage fright. And I think it's very true. I worry for, like all of us, for my children, for my students, for my finances, for my health, you know, all the things of daily life. And somehow, when I play music, I feel like I'm floating in the outside of my body, and I'm just the music itself. I'm with the music itself. And so what I do in the improvisations is, of course, the essence of an improvisation is you don't know the end. The essence of composing is to organize a plan so you know roughly where you want to go. It's like driving without GPS and just enjoying the places, or having an idea in mind where to go. Mademoiselle Boulanger, when I was very young, was trying to always find very touchingly childish ways to explain things that are musically essential for most in theory. And I still till today remember it so clearly when she said, you know what I mean? It's not when you buy your ticket that I spoiled it. Mademoiselle will be upset. Pay attention. Okay, I'm sorry. Take two. It's not when you board the train that you start the journey, it's when you buy the ticket. And that was specifically about modulation. It's not when you're already with a, let's say, accidental note in the next tonality to enter that you already modulated. You modulated before you moved. You already had the intention to move. And in that sense, when you improvise, you have an intention that's short term, that is always ahead of you, but it's like driving at night without headlights. It's very liberating because it's not real. Because in fact the accidents don't matter on the improvisation. And you don't have a plan. But what you do have is a flaw. And I must confess that the melodic line of the A section of Le Parfum de l'âme was an improvised section. Mi si si do do si la so so la si mi si si mi so sol fa mi re re mi mi. And then what after? Mi si mi sol si la so fa fa so so. And it appeals to you what comes next because it talks to you about it. It's almost like as if I like to say composing is like memorizing, sight-reading memorization. It's like as if you retrieve something from a deep past, it's a reminiscence that comes back to you, and then you know, oh, that's the right thing. That's what it was. I still remember my little Nadia when she was 5, she was playing around the piano and she would hear me, typical for composers, when I write, I search for the right ending. You never find the right ending. It's too long, too short, too early, too late, too up, too low, too down, too repetitive, too predictable, too everything. And so I remember at one point I was scratching with my eraser, like Mademoiselle would have liked, and I finally speak loud voice to myself, I finally found the right ending. And Nadia was playing with her toys, and she was telling me, but Daddy, how can it be right since you make it up in the first place? And this self-evidence, as they say, the truth comes from the mouth of the children, is so beautiful, it keeps you down to earth. And she was amused to see me struggle to find an end when I was insisting that she plays right the piece that she was learning, because it's written by somebody else. And the idea that you struggle about finding something that is right, and when do you know it's right? Mademoiselle Boulanger used to speak in composition about la note choisie, the chosen note. They asked Ravel, when he was composing his piano trio, Maître, are you almost finished? And he goes, oh yeah, it's all mapped. All I have to do now is put the notes. And they used to say that some composers like him were really structurally composing the piece before, but they managed to have it flow as if it's improvised. Now, what was not improvised was the B section. Mi fa sol fa mi re, re mi fa mi re do, do re mi re do si. The problem with tonal music is that if it's very evident, it sounds almost cheesy, popish. And people would say that with a certain disdain. If it was dodecaphonic or chromatic, they would say, oh. And so to write simple and not appear simplistic is like being, you know, basically an idiot. You don't know what you're doing. But I think that Prokofiev does that very interestingly. He writes beautifully, and all of a sudden he dirts it up, harmonically speaking. This is kind of a psychological necessity for him to add a polytonality on it, to make something that sounds very, it's him. It's like C major with dirt on it. And then if you play something that is very tonal, very sweet, very guessable, because mi fa sol fa mi re, and then you do re mi fa mi re do, and somebody will say do re mi re do si, si do re do si la, and then people will say, yeah, everybody has done that before you. You're, you know, and then you start thinking, okay, mi fa sol fa mi re, and I'll do re mi fa si re do, and I'll modulate do re mi da do si, and I'll add a chromaticism, I'll add something just to not to be the flow. And I must say that it took me quite a long time to accept that I'm not going to be a savant composer. I'll be just a composer as much as I can be, which is a composer of my inner world, which is relatively candid. And I have no shame to have written Mi fa sol fa mi fa mi re do si. Even if I understand that people could consider it lounge music, cheesy, cheap, repetitive, predictable, sweet. I mean, but pejorative, you know, not as a quality. And you know what is strange? Is that when you get out of a place, movie theater, symphony concert like yesterday, or the concert was, you come out and you go, my God, Fanasido. What a great thing. I mean, of course, it's savant, it's beautifully written, orchestrated, the piano plays more notes in a square centimeter than possible. But then, okay, the virtuosity sections are very fascinating, but you get out of there and you almost whistle the song because it touches you emotionally. I always found that the quality of a melody is like the perfume of somebody you loved, and it remains with you, even if the person is no more there because they have another life or they left. It's the same expression I had with the first theme of the G minor Saint-Saëns concertos. Si, la, si, fa, fa, sol, sol, fa, mi, re. If somebody told him, do, re, fa, si, la, sol, re, do, the first ballad in G minor has almost the same notes. You're doing the same piece. And I'm so glad he did. Because that's what I regret when some students who composed, they give up on composition because they think, ah, it's not good enough, and who am I next to Chopin and all this. And if you keep the piece of yours, and they'll say, you're arrogant. And if you erase it, they'll say, oh, what a beautiful humility. but if you know what happened to Duparc, I don't know if you know Henri Duparc, he wrote 15 or 16 songs, way more, and way more music than that, but he dumped it all in the Seine River before he died because he thought all his music was worth nothing. Except this 15th song, which were the publisher, which today we love to play. And so I think he was wrong. It's up to us to say, perhaps we like, perhaps not, but you can, in other words, if you keep it, you're arrogant. If you throw it away, you're humble. But then if you're dead, you're forgotten. And if you're alive and you play your own piece, they say, oh yeah, because you're a composer. And I always like to think, nobody accused, or not accused, nobody subjected when they invited Chopin in a salon that he didn't play a Beethoven sonata. They suspected that Mozart will play Mozart and Chopin will play Chopin. And Liszt is the first one who was very generous to play the others and actually created our trouble of this recital programs. But before him it was accepted that if they invite Bach, he'll play Bach. And then asked Bach, could you play something by Handel, please? And I don't think that it was considered that the composer would play their performer other than their own work, just like the farmer's market, you know? They bring their production. And I find that the separation between the interpretation and the performance happened mostly because of the recordings. Because the recordings allowed to develop an art of the interpretation that became a composition over the composition itself. And you start saying, I like Bach, but by Glenn Gould. Not by Bach, for Bach. Because if I hear it by Rosalind Turek, oh, no, 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 but I prefer Glenn Gould. And somebody says, oh, not at all, I hate it. I prefer it with, you know, a Schiff. And so it becomes, the interpretation becomes the vector of the piece. And then, of course, composers hate interpretation because they think it's a betrayal. Like Ravel would say, on ne m'interprète pas, on me joue. One doesn't play interpretation of my music, one plays my notes. As if it's all in the notes, but in fact not, the notation is not sufficient. And so we need interpretations, we need creative revisitation of the pieces. That's how the pieces blossom with each generation differently and beautifully. And I think that in composition, very often the days now are the separation. The people who compose don't play. The people who play don't compose, mostly. The people who think the music, musicologists, perhaps, what do you call those, scholars, They write articles and books about the piece you play. They know more about the piece you play than you when you played. And the composers compose in some other realms, and all of a sudden there is less connection with the performer. And if you, I think it's to do with the century. Everything is specialized very early in education because there's so much to know that if you want to be successful, you should just go into the whatever. And if not, you'll be one of these idiot savants, basically.
We have been doing these conversations for the past, what, 5-6 years. But I must say, you're the easiest person to interview. One last question from somebody who welcomes volunteers. Come on.
May I have the last question?
Yes.
It's not an intellectual or philosophical question, it's just my personal curiosity. I read, of course, online that you studied with Madame Boulanger until her very last day. My curiosity is that when was the very last encounter, your personal encounter with her, and what was she like in her last days?
So the last 2 months of her life, which she died on October 22nd, 1979, she was in a sort of somnolence coma, not coma, because it's not coma, somnolence, I would say. And I was the only student she was teaching in the last months. She had an Italian butler, Giuseppe, who would call my mother, since I always lived with Mama, was married to Mama, always with Mama. By the time I was already 17, but still called Mama. La signorina est prête pour une leçon avec me. He was Italian, so he called her La signorina. He's ready for a lesson with Emile. And I would arrive 45 minutes later because the very subways are something else, especially when they work. Most of the time they're on strike. And you have to walk a lot more. But anyway, I would rush. And I would be amazed to see that Mademoiselle Boulanger would make an intellectual effort, a physical effort, to give me a lesson, which lasted perhaps less than an hour at that point, but she was there. And, but very there, very there. Meaning, not somnolent, not uncomfortable, not complaining, she never complained, but very, for instance, give an example. She was always giving the example, like most teachers, on the top of the piano, because she was sitting to the right of the student. I personally made it a point to always sit on the left of the student, because I find it's more practical to play more in the middle of the keyboard, because on the top it sounds always like you play on the bones of the music. I always dreamed, actually, that piano builders would build a middle 2-octave piano that is clickable on each side according to where you sit. So you always give an example in the middle register, because it's uncomfortable if you don't have 2 pianos to play and the student feels like... I mean, it's not practical. And if not, you play the top. And how many students and teachers did they have playing in the top? Where most of the pianos in the teacher's studios were broken strings out of tune, and they would say, sing with intensity, and it sounds really clinking. You know that very well. I'm sure it reminds people's example. I believe that too. And that one of the last lessons, she was doing a fugue exercise that I wrote. And she told me that when she was in the conservatory as a student, the exam for the fugue was, they give you a piece of paper with the 4 or 5 bars of the theme, and you have to watch it during 5 minutes in front of the jury, without to play, and organize in your mind all the combinations that you can do with this subject in terms of the contrapuntal things. And then you have to play a 4-movement symphony on the organ, based on this theme, with chorale, with fugue, with everything. In other words, all the things that she learned, or everybody learns mostly in writing, but in real time. And while she was telling me this, she started playing on the subject that I wrote my fugue. Do, fa, mi, re, re, do, fa, si, re, do, si, line, F minor, chromatic, I remember that. And she was continuously playing. She was unable to see, so she was playing on the upper register there. And she says, and now I'm going to end, sorry, forgot the ice cream. She would say something like, oh, you know, and now I'm going to enter the second subject in retrograde motion on the dominant. And now I'm going to play in augmentation the entrance of the subject in reverse. And while she's saying that, she's playing. But she's, can you hold this for a second? I'm sorry. She's playing like this and talking. You know what I mean? Not seeing it. It's almost like, and I was thinking, how fascinating. She's doing it almost like in 2001 Space Odyssey, that computer that goes crazy before dying. Have you ever seen this film by Stanley Kubrick? After this lesson, I went several times to see her on her deathbed, where she was reminiscing herself, voice by voice, fugues of Bach to maintain her brain from falling totally asleep. Solfège style, you know, when you don't sing, but you just use the syllables. I don't know if you do this in this school. Some schools do it with numbers, some do it with pitches. Kodály style, perhaps, yeah. Well, anyway, sorry, so la, si, so si, so mi, do, si, re, mi, la. And then I would start the second voice, holding her hand, and we recite basically 2 voices of a 4-bar or 4-voice fugue by Bach on the well-tempered clavier, without anything but just saying it to each other. Then she wrote, or she had her secretary dictated to her a little letter for me to give to me after she passes away. As a very short note that says, mon petit Émile, je sais combien tu sais que tu me dois, mais sache que je t'en dois bien plus encore. Which is translated in English would be, my little Émile, I know that you're aware of how much you owe me. Not money, obviously. In English, it doesn't sound like that. But how much you... Yeah. But just know that I owe you much more. And it was incomprehensible for 18-year-old Emil. It was so asymmetrical to be next to her. And it's only when I became a teacher that I understood what she meant. It's so true. It's so true. We all learn from our students. They make us discover things about the pieces we didn't think of, or aspects or ways. And sometimes they even make me discover that I always misread a note. That's why I always promise myself, because when you teach many hours, sometimes you listen without to look at the score for a second, and when you hear something that you think is a wrong note, you say, ah, you did a wrong note to correct it, you know? And I was thinking, and what if I did? We said it 30 years ago, and I've always played it wrong, and it very often, unfortunately, proves me that I was wrong. But what I wanted to say is that Mademoiselle Boulanger wrote to me this note because I think she was aware of my sense of loss after her guidance. And the idea that I could have brought her something was soothing in a way for me also, but later. And the last thing I must say is that, as I must have said in masterclass, perhaps I hate repeating myself, but as you would say, teachers repeat themselves all the time. There was one thing that was essential to her, is the fact that you need to be polite. And she really hated people with bad manners. But really, in a way that is possibly detached from the reality of what today we accept in society, where it's more free-going. And she always told me, Emil, people are not born polite. They become polite. And the best part is when they don't think about being polite, and they are. And she always told me to make sure that I apply that to myself about my studies with her. She said, I think you will have to forget most of what I taught you now and just do what you do. And if it's not in by now, it's too late. And I felt like, how can I summarize all what she brought me to myself after she died? Was it this, that aspect of music making, hearing, thinking, organizing, teaching, and of course not teaching that yet. But I think it was very touching that she was really thinking that the important is what you become and not just how much knowledge you sort of project or sometimes display. And I think the idea of il faut tout oublier is very difficult to do, but very essential. And then you realize how much substance has left in you. And I find that for having had an exceptional mother, and I think most people can say that for theirs, if not everybody, I had an exceptional childhood because of these two ladies, my mom and her. And as Nietzsche said often, he says, adulthood is only the reflection of your childhood. I think that it shaped me a lot. The fact that this snippet exists on video today is only made me more ashamed because so many of my students who go to IU in Indiana, they take a course in musicology or history of music, rather. At some point, they're projected this video. And they usually come to the lesson and say, Professor, we saw you as a child. And it's almost as if I was a little monster. And I think that the fact that it's frozen in time and it can be re-seen out of the context of its time is very disturbing to me. Because I find it's like defining somebody, for instance, when Mademoiselle Boulanger died, she was 90 many, perhaps five, six. But the point is that I only knew a little portion of her life that I was privileged to be next to her. And then I started being, for all the years since then, curious to know how was she when she was young? What did she do? And when I asked many of my former colleague students whom I didn't meet when I was her student, I got a cacophony of opinions about what she brought to them. Quincy Jones confuses her students being Ravel and Copland. No, Ravel was her co-student and Copland was her student. And it starts like that. And then you go on Jean Francais, Dutilleux, Bob Levin. I don't know if you've heard him here.
Yeah.
He was one of these Boulanger wizards who can read in 17 clefs and insert all that. I think that what I learned is that all her life long, at least after the death of her sister, she chose really to devote herself to her students. Commission pieces to Copland, perform the organ for his organ symphony, believe in composers like Astor Piazzolla, who was playing tangos in Pigalle, which is the red light district of Paris, to pay his lessons where he studied how to write Haydn sonatas. And she encouraged him to play for her music of his country that he told me he didn't dare, because tango in the 60s, 70s was considered dirty music, not noble to be in a concert hall. Let's study with Boulanger. It's almost like going to see the Pope and say, I'm going to play hard rock for you. It was very, very embarrassing. And I think that the combination of her intellectual curiosity, openness to all these different people who came to her and who had accomplished themselves with her help to become themselves. Piazzolla didn't become another Fauré, and Quincy Jones didn't become another Fauré, etc. Bernstein didn't study with her, even if he claims it. I studied with him enough to know that he didn't study with her. But people like to claim this. For Barenboim is claimed that he studied with her. And she told me that he came to her apartment, that same place with the organ, and she said he was 7 years old and he played the Pastoral Symphony by Beethoven on the organ for her. What a weird thing to do. Which is how I remember it. And she remembers telling me, you know, he was so gifted and I was so worried for him, but his father told me he has no time to lose to study with you. He's already ready. And I think that she regretted perhaps some that didn't work out because they didn't accept her old-fashioned pace of things. And I think in a way my father accepted it, and I am very thankful to him that it gave me the opportunity to take the time to develop a musical awareness and rising until her death that was not shattered by her death or shut down like the light is off and then I'm off too. In fact, I realized how beautiful her analysis classes were for me personally, because they taught me how to teach myself, which was not meant to be that, but it's what happened. And so when I performed pieces I studied with her, inevitably they have a different flavor for me. Very often when I play, I see her next to me, visually. The famous lieutenant, la main droite. Or the, I don't understand. You cannot transpose in C flat major this Fauré song? It's only 7 flats. And I remember saying, Mademoiselle, it's in the maximum. 7 flats. And it was intolerable that Emile would make a mistake, because if I make a mistake, that meant that I was immediately put the guilt trip. Your parents, the creator, everybody, you receive this gift. How do you dare make a mistake in this transposition in C flat major? You're not patient enough, attentive enough, you don't read ahead enough, etc. So I think that old-fashioned way, in the beginning as a child, I found a little bit strange. But I must say that the evocation of this last solfeggio of the Bach fugue was a beautiful way to close that loop. And I thought, after all, there is merit to all this grammar of music. And I was very touched that I could share this solfeggio of Bach fugues with her on her deathbed. I think it was an enormously unexpected gift that I was given. And very often I recall these moments, because they were not short. We went through fugues and fugues and fugues, and she would always start a new one. Thankfully, I had memorized them by that time, because then she would have been really upset if I'm not in the right control subject. Anyway, to say that she's alive in me is an understatement. To say that I dream of her like I have my dad. things, like most of us do, if we do, is because it's in our subconscious. And it's part of our life. I remember I was a little bit of an impolite child with my mother when I was telling her, why didn't you give me birth earlier so I could spend more time with Mademoiselle now that she's dead? It's a silly thing to say, which proves how immature I was in life compared to the maturity in the exercises or the pieces I was working on. And I think that kind of balance between remaining candid and child was a little bit of a dangerous combination, but she didn't push more. The only thing she didn't like is people putting my age on the program when I was a child. She absolutely hated that. She thought it was very bad to justify or explain. Oh, he's small, so it's okay. It is or it is not. And that's what she was always saying. And I think it's very important that she was not a touchy-feely person, like, okay, it's better, it's okay, you'll do better next time. And so in a way, every time was the only time. And because of her age and my age, Mademoiselle Boulanger, my mother, was very polite with her. And she says, Mademoiselle, the little one will take a vacation with, perhaps, with his father, and we'll go perhaps a little few weeks. And Mademoiselle was, Madame, il n'y a pas de vacances quand on a le don d'Emile. There's no vacation when we have the gift of Emile. Emile has to work. And I remember she telling me, Emile, do you know what is vacation? And I say, no, c'est quoi? She says, c'est le moment de faire des progrès. It's the moment to progress during vacation. And I remember looking at her saying, so you mean I didn't progress during the semester? Because students don't know if they do. They always need the reassurance or some kind of temperature check. You know, am I okay? And she was saying, oh, but it's nothing to do. When you have vacation, you can focus even more on your work. In other words, it's not work, since it's passion or drive or call. And I think that because of her age and mine, I was living on a daily stopwatch. Every lesson is the last, potentially. Every day she can basically die. Because I was 7, she was 84, and she's already undertaking my musical growth. And so there was the idea that we are here only for that. And so my studies in school, my home studies, everything was focused towards Mademoiselle, Mademoiselle, Mademoiselle. And thankfully, it didn't produce psychologically in me somebody who tries to make the students feel the same pressure. I'm very happy when students take vacation. I even tell them, isn't it amazing? After the vacation, you play better than during the lessons. You took time, and it's already more deep in you what I was teaching. So from a week to another, it doesn't progress as much as when you take off. And I think it's important to understand that I was very lucky because it was a one-to-one transmission at a very intense level that is difficult to duplicate in the system of schools that we live in. And what I do in my lessons with my students is that I always leave that extra time that I add to do a little bit more than what the task was of the day in terms of sight reading a piece. And that's a little bit of the legacy of hers. Or explaining more the piece, or thinking about other pieces related to this piece, just expanding the horizons. That's a very good thing she did, exponentially expanding the horizon lines for our minds.
Thank you very much.
And in turn, you have expanded our horizons. Thank you so much for coming.